Hello, ladies and gentlemen, it's Jeremy Vaeni, and you are listening to The Experience. Yay, welcome back, everyone. We're into the two-hour monthly extravaganza. Actually, this one goes a little over 2 hours, so you're welcome. If you are a non-subscriber, of course, you're getting probably a little over a half hour of this. That means you got a lot more to go, so click that subscribe tab and get the entire episode where I will be discussing alien abductions, visitor experiences with Robert, who is the young man who told his sister Crystal to check out our show and consider coming on. You remember we had some amazing conversations with her in a solo and then a roundtable discussion. I think that was the last episode was the roundtable, right? Well, this is her brother, and he's had some experiences of his own, and we're going to get into them. And we're also going to wax philosophical and... not that the non-subscribers will hear, but I'm going to tell the story of how giant stones are moved by nature cultures. It just kept nagging at me this whole time, and so you're going to finally hear that story. Whether you choose to believe it or not, you now at least have a completely new option other than aliens did it, ancient aliens, or slave labor. No, there is another. And then Tyler Cokejohn, my good buddy, old pal, old friend, is going to come on and talk about some of the alien abduction tropes, some of which we hear in here, about nosebleeds and things like this. And we're going to see if we can't find an answer in medical science for these things. And if not, well, where else should we be looking? And then ultimately we're going to be talking about New Age versus science, but you're going to be surprised who's on which side of the issue, I think, on this one. Spoiler alert, question mark? Okay, let's get ready, get set. I am excited that this is now a two-hour extravaganza show. I feel like I have actually more freedom to do more things with the show, which you would think is not the case. You'd think, like, doing a weekly show would be better for that. But, I don't know. At the moment, I feel free to be you and me, so let's get to it. For non-subscribers, after these messages, we will be talking to Robert about his experiences and more. For subscribers, dig in. Aloha, Jeremy Vaeni here, and I want to tell you about my latest undertaking, OurUndoing.com. OurUndoing.com is a multimedia website where if you watch, if you read, if you listen, without trying to absorb knowledge like we do with normal learning, and without the normal judgmental filters that we use to compare and contrast so-called spiritual knowledge, if we watch, if we read, if we listen, without all of that, we may just wake up to our full human nature. That is what this website is for. It's not about what we're doing, it's about who we are, truly are, when we're off the pendulum of duality. If your life is about seeking truth above all else, look no further. Join me at OurUndoing.com.
Whitley Strieber has published an incredible two-volume historical novel called In Hitler's House under his open pseudonym Jonathan Lane. This amazing story follows the life of William Weber, who meets Hitler while touring Germany in 1931 and becomes his friend and confidant. But then, when he realizes the truth, becomes a spy in Hitler's house for the Allies. Living a life of terrible danger, he falls in love with another of Hitler's secret friends, also a spy in his house. This is a story of espionage and desperate love, and the deepest portrait of Adolf Hitler ever created. Don't miss In Hitler's House, available in paperback and as an ebook on Amazon.
Ladies and gentlemen, without further ado, please welcome to the program, Robert. Robert, thank you so much for, well, giving us Crystal and then doing this.
Thank you. You're welcome. Yeah, I'm glad to be here.
So this is fascinating to me because, you know, what your sister described is all over the map and has sort of multidimensional implications. But it sounds like from what she was saying that you've had more you know, what we would consider to be visitor or alien abduction type experiences. And so before we get into those, I just want to say, like, what is your feeling based on what you've heard from your sister about the nature of these experiences? Like, has her hearing from her made you rethink what yours could be, or are you pretty firm that they're both either completely different or getting to something alien?
Yeah, well, I think there's been a little bit of a confusion. The comment that my sister made that I think you're referring to, she's explaining that I have been introducing her to these concepts about the possibility of me having been abducted, about small blue aliens, and about shadow people. Now, that was a list that would have been separated by commas, not a list of things that I've experienced, but things that I've discussed with her.
Ah, okay.
So the truth is, I don't know if I've been abducted. I don't have a memory of being abducted. But the possibility came to my mind when I started looking at some clues with correlations with the abduction experience. After I went to a group of experiencers, I met with a group of experiencers through Meetup in Portland, Oregon, and was speaking with them about my experiences, and I actually had not had one yet. I started getting into the UFO thing before I even had any proof or any experience myself. And it just became fascinating out of the blue for me. And then they had brought up the possibility that what if you were abducted? Like, would there be any evidence? And I was like, well, I never even thought about it that way. But truth is, when I was a kid, I had a lot of nosebleeds. I would fight doctors when they would try to give me a shot. There would be like six doctors holding me down just to give me an injection. And I feel like I had this innate fear, this internal fear of hospitals and doctors at the time, especially needles. Everyone does. Everyone gets nosebleeds. I slept between my bed and the wall as if just not thinking about it. It was just, I felt more comfortable hiding between the, like, way down in the corner of the room. The movie Close Encounters of the Third Kind really freaked me out when the little baby, the toddler, was abducted in the beginning of the movie, or so toward the beginning. And that was the scariest thing. There was, I think it might have been another a horror movie, maybe Poltergeist or something, that I saw a snippet of from as a kid when my parents weren't showing me Close Encounters of the Third Kind. They weren't showing me any the Poltergeist. We were sneaking around while the parents were watching the adult movies. We were sneaking around the background when we were supposed to be in bed and catching glimpses of this. But there was one ghost on the stairwell, under the stairs, actually, when someone's running for the stairs. And it's just a stupid-looking ghost, but when I thought about it, well, as a kid, it really freaked me out. When I thought about it later, the face kind of looks a little bit like a gray. So these little clues were like creeping in as to like what was freaking me out as a kid. And then when I was in high school, I stayed at a friend's house, at their mom's house. And I woke up in the middle of the night, sitting upright in bed, at the end of a scream or a man yell. I was like, I could hear my own yell echoing. But I was no longer yelling. And I was suddenly awakened and sitting upright. And that was just nothing that's ever happened to me before or since in my life. And I hadn't remembered any dream or anything going on. I was just put in this situation. Then there was one other experience I had in college that involved a ghost moment, and then I had a UFO experience. So that's sort of my experience with the subject matter. My UFO experience was in 2016.
Well, wait a second.
Let me
just unpack this a little bit. So when you come to the point in your life where you start opening books about UFOs and things like this, is this going to be before the UFO encounter? Like, are you seeing documentaries and reading these books based on what feels like just a normal sort of interest, and then you see things about nosebleeds and that sort of thing, and you go, oh, wait a minute, this could be me?
Yes, yeah, that sounds right.
And that's before the UFO event?
Yes, okay. That was before the UFO, but still I was very skeptical about it. And I didn't tell my sister of this suspicion until a lot later. And she's a little more convinced that most likely I've been abducted. I'm not. But I do entertain the possibility. And I also think that if I had, I was probably a screamer. And whoever the visitors are, they probably don't like yelling and screaming really scared children. I think that my response to the paranormal is one of fear.
So this is interesting, because if you're not an experiencer, how interesting would it be that you spend some part of your life investigating whether you are or not, and then think like, well, maybe I'm not, but then all of a sudden your sister is? Like, that would be just fascinating if that were true.
Yeah. Well, what's interesting is I've heard someone else say something that rang true with my life, is that I don't know how much truth there is to this, but many experiencers don't actually witness a UFO or some other type of paranormal experience until after they've decided to entertain a belief in the subject matter. Does that make sense?
Yeah. But it's not just a belief. Yeah. Well, yeah, certainly. It's, you know, my old broadcast partner, Jeff Ritzman, used to say, the more you give, the more you get. It's as if there is something dangling a carrot and it wants to create a feedback loop with you. But he would always say to people, if you want to have a paranormal or a ufological experience, you can. But it's almost a cult-like. It's like you have to be sort of deeply in your marrow obsessive about it, in a way where the air in the room changes. So it's not just like, I wish I could see a UFO. I'm going to go sit on this rock here and just wait. Well, I didn't see one. Yeah. It's like, no, you have to, like, all of your intention has to be into that really deeply. And then I would even add to that, maybe you let it go. Like, what, there's something about, like, obsessively holding an intention and then letting it go, where it then sort of comes to you in some weird way. I do think that's true with this. Even just having conversations, like deep conversations. I mean, we've had it happen on the show where things just go haywire in the room and it seems to like provoke something in the atmosphere. It's an odd thing.
Yeah, this is exactly my experience. I was an extreme atheist. I was very science minded. I still am, but I don't let it. I was also just not really into religion. I was too modest to accept the idea that a god gives a care about the drama of our daily lives. That everyone's thinking that. It just seemed too human centric, too anthropocentric, for me to embrace religion. And I just discounted everything, including the paranormal, as like smoke and mirrors. But there was this experience a friend of mine had where a light came out of the clouds down and split into two lights and went back up into the clouds. This was off the San Francisco Golden Gate Bridge. And you hear about these stories. I was a young adult, and this friend was very credible to me. And they said this, they said this story. And then, later in life, as a later adult, another person who I thought was very credible, had a strong belief in sort of the ancient alien theory that was before Ancient Aliens was on TV. And then it was all new to me, and it all seemed very tacky, honestly, the aesthetics of the whole alien encounter situation, the green heads and stuff. It never appealed to me. But the idea started creeping into my head of like, what if, you know, these credible people have interesting things to say about this? Well, what if? So I actually went to a couple of UFO groups through Meetup and started talking with other experiencers, and I started becoming more convinced of the possibility, though, you know, I always had this sort of phrase in my mind that I would never bet my life on it. That's kind of like, I'm like, I'll entertain a belief in it, but I wouldn't bet my life on it. And then it happened to me. And like I said, in 2016, when I was walking through Portland with my wife of the time, we both witnessed an object in the sky, hovering above us, and it wasn't a spacecraft for sure. And I could tell you why, but, if you want, I can describe that experience.
Yeah, absolutely.
Okay. Yeah. So I look up, we're walking. First thing I probably should say, just some fodder for the skeptics. Neither of us was sober at this time, but we were walking down the sidewalk going, through our own neighborhood, about maybe five blocks from our home, and hovering up in the sky about, I'm going to say about 40 feet, and that might even be overestimating, was sort of a square black light. And I noticed out of the corner of my eye, and I start to say, look at that drone. And I turn around and I say, look at that. And I'm pointing in the sky, and I can't finish the statement because I'm like, that's not a drone. It's silent. it's black. It's radiating black light, like beams of blackness that not like a purple light you would see in a nightclub, but like just pitch black with beams as if you were looking at a star. And it was square with rounded edges like a pillow. And it started, it's almost like it noticed us noticing it. And so it started to move away from us. And then it started taking on this motion of like a flip-flopping, like a falling leaf, sort of a, like the right side raised up, and then it came back down and rolled around, the left side raised up, and then it did a flip and flopped and flipped and flopped. But it never changed its trajectory, and it never lost altitude. It just started heading over the neighborhood very slowly at first. And as it was flip-flopping, I was seeing these smaller red lights moving inside of the blackness, maybe like four or five red lights within the black that had no definition. I was focusing all my attention on this thing and could not see one edge or one rivet or one clear line. I was like doing my best to define this thing, and it was just too blurry. It was like trying to look into a light, essentially. You don't see any edges. And then it picked up speed, but the flip-flopping remained really graceful and slow. Oh, there was another thing I noticed when it was flip-flopping. I got a profile view of it, and it was paper thin. There was no body to it, so it couldn't have been a spacecraft, or, I mean, well, it could have been, sure, anything's possible, a spacecraft in another dimension through which we only see this light representing its toe stepping on our dimension. You know, I'm just throwing out some ideas. So I couldn't see a body to it, just a paper-thin light. It was the weirdest thing. Sped up very suddenly, was speeding up very fast, gained an incredible acceleration. It didn't do the Star Trek zoom off as like one bolt of light, but it went away from us so quickly that I thought it might have been getting smaller rather than going further. I mean, it defied logic that it would be going so fast, and also remained graceful in its flip-flopping like a falling leaf or a rising ash out of a fire. It never started fluttering fast that you would expect from something going at such a high velocity through an atmosphere. And that was the experience. I was in awe. That was not one of fright.
Were there other people in the street?
No, just the two of us.
Huh. Okay.
We'll be back after this.
The new unknowncountry.com is on the way. There'll be exciting new graphics, much easier navigation, the ability to subscribe either with your credit card or using PayPal, the return of our free message board and subscriber chat room, and so much more. The new site will be intuitive and easy to use, but it will also be demonstrated and explained on Whitley's YouTube channel. As to when, well, we're hopefully just weeks away.
You know, The Afterlife Revolution is a funny book. It makes people happy, even though it's about the afterlife and thinking about crossing over. It made me happy to write it. And the reason it did was that I was actually in touch with Anne while I was writing it. And not only that, she proved it. She proved it clearly and completely. When you read the book, you'll see what I mean. You'll see why Dr. Gary Schwartz, who is one of the leading experts on the afterlife, considers it such an important book, why he wrote a foreword for it. Because this is about something real and incredible that we are told every day not to believe that we have souls and that we have an afterlife. Well, we do. We do. And The Afterlife Revolution is going to open the door for you, so you're not going to be thinking to yourself, maybe I don't, when you do. And that's why it's a book of joy. Go on Amazon, take a look at the great reviews, and get yourself a copy. It's available for your Kindle, it's available in paperback, and there's an audiobook read by me. And let me tell you something. You can hear something in my voice. People tell me that, and I think it's true. You know what it is? It's the inner joy that is part of me and has become part of me since this extraordinary thing happened. I have to say And Strieber was a remarkable person in this life, and she still is. Get it today.
Whitley Strieber's nonfiction is magical, powerful, and thought-provoking. From Communion to the Afterlife Revolution, there is no body of work like it in the world. Nothing even approaches it. And not only that, his wonderful fiction, from The Wolfen to his latest novel, New, offers reading and listening entertainment that you will never forget. And where do you find all this in one place? At Strieber.com. That's where. Every Whitley Strieber book available for sale is there. So don't wait. Go to Strieber.com and start exploring. There's only one Whitley and only one place to find all his work. Strieber.com.
Welcome back.
Now, my wife at the time was an extreme skeptic, and so this was a lot for her to handle. She was already a little bit baffled at my willingness to be into this UFO stuff and to be kind of embracing some truth to it. She found it maybe, I think she might have found it a little embarrassing even. But after this point, she kind of had to let it go.
Well, when you talk to her about it, did she have the same memory, or does she have the same visual? Do your descriptions agree?
That is a great question, and the answer is no. She saw the same thing I was seeing, but she saw something different, which was she said it looked like a flame in the shape of a diamond. She said it looked like a red flame in the shape of a diamond, and that it did the same motion. She saw it like flip-flopping and speed away really quick. But when I saw a black square with red lights in it, she saw an all red diamond flame. We're like our perspectives were 2 feet up. Her head was 2 feet from my head. We're looking at the same thing. We both see this thing and we see two different things. It was really, really amazing.
And so when you said you were inebriated, what was it, alcohol or something else?
Probably alcohol and weed.
Oh, alcohol and weed. Okay. So not like a real giant hallucinogen or something.
No, and not enough weed to be hallucinating either. Not like a 4 foot bong kind of weed. Right. It was like a weeknight.
We were just having a little bit of a celebration. I'm just going to assume that you've had weed and alcohol before and that you've never seen anything like this on weed and alcohol.
Yeah.
Okay, so that's the first. And as this is happening, what is your state of mind? Is it, well, I'll just put it, I don't want to front load the question. What is your state of mind, would you say, as this is unfolding? Like, what are you feeling about what you're saying?
It was reverence. I was just mouth agape and just blown away and amazed. Some people say that they can feel a psychic connection with something they witness in the sky or in a visitor present in their space. And I did not have that. It was simply, I was a spectator. But what I was seeing, I was awestruck. It was that beautiful to me, beautiful in the sense that it was so foreign and unreal. Like, never, I mean, it was real because I really did believe it was there, but, unlike anything I'd ever seen before is what I mean as unreal.
Right.
But, yeah.
And was there a sense of, when you say foreign, was it completely foreign, or was there even an inkling of familiarity in some way with this, or no?
Yeah, no. I had no personalization of this. My assumption immediately afterwards was that it must have been having something to do with the house that we had walked past. Like, I was tempted to walk up to their door and ask them if they had just been visited by visitors
right.
in Portland. So maybe that would have been acceptable, but I didn't because I didn't. I was not sober, like I said, and I didn't want to be a bother. But I kind of thought that I had witnessed something I wasn't supposed to. And it wasn't until more recently that I started questioning the possibility that some people will say that when you see something like this, you are meant to see it. And that also, you know, I always resist this anthropocentric kind of like, or this even like me centric sort of interpretation where, oh, this is about me.
It's definitely,
for the most part,
not me centric, but, What are the odds that really this high tech whatever is startled that you're? I mean, how does something in the sky, first of all, sort of recognize that you recognize it, and then start doing a little bit of a performance, seemingly for you? Why is, you know what I mean? Like, if it doesn't want to be seen at all, why is it showing red lights and this sort of thing, or looking like a flame? Just the whole thing begs its own questions, you know?
You've got a good point there. It, from other people's experiences, it could have disappeared if it wanted to, is my understanding. These things are somehow able to just disappear. I'm not sure if that's entirely true, but it was around dusk, so it wasn't nighttime yet. The sun had set, and there were some wispy clouds in the sky. I could see daylight still in the sky, and it wasn't a windy day, so I didn't think it was something just blowing through the sky, especially since it had been hovering at first, and then all of a sudden it was traveling at this high velocity. So I was able to see visually, I was able to see the trees that it went past and the rooftops that it went over. So it's not like it was like nighttime. Maybe the things that disappear are easily disappearing at night rather than in the daytime. I'm not sure how it works. But
so what do you think moving in the sky? Do you think that there is a craft there, or do you think that there's a portal that's moving around with this thing? Because it just strikes me listening to this and then remembering what your sister said about this, what she thought was a blue light that came up to her and sort of opened up and revealed, no, it's actually like a moving portal of some sort.
Yeah. You see, moving. I think that when, and no, so the answer to your question is I don't know. But in my best guess, and I've thought about it long and hard, right? Because you can't not think about something like this when it happens to you. I have this interpretation that when the visitors, whatever variety they are, when they travel through our space, they look like a light. I kind of think that's what's happening. And I don't know if that's because it's a portal or a craft or just what something in another dimension moving by us would look like is some kind of light. I don't. There's so many possibilities, right? But I remember reading Communion, and Whitley Strieber pointed out that this light came down into the yard in front of his family's house. And his family was actually out there in the driveway or in the yard, in the front, I guess, is what I remember it as. The light comes down, and out of it emerges a mantid. And that just rings true to me. My sister saw this orb that started revealing blue scales behind it, which could possibly be, my interpretation of that is that it was something's skin, but it's also very possible that a craft or anything else could be biomimicry or just scales or fun. You know, it could have been anything made looking like scales. But it seems to be that these things move in lights, and the lights tend to be orbs, but this thing was not an orb. Still, I think my interpretation is that I think something was moving through my neighborhood, and it could have been just one entity without a craft, or it could have been this portal, like you said. These portals could be mobile. We always think of portals as a fixed position, but what if a mobile portal is actually a method of transport?
Yeah, but possible. But then what do you think about the actual event itself? Like, I guess I'm in my life now I'm at the question of, could how we react to these things go any other way? Could this have unfolded any other way? I mean, could you have been in your right mind and tried to take a picture of it or tried to signal it if you had a cell phone or something? Or does it automatically go this way? And just because as you're talking, I'm thinking about this thing that happened to me in high school where I'm driving with my friends. We're going past a cemetery of all places late at night coming back from a party. And there are these blue lights that are dancing in the trees. And, you know, at this point, I have a bunch of experiences and my friends know about it. And the one driving is a complete skeptic. And he won't even look. He's like, oh, yeah, right. He won't even turn his head to look until our other friend in the back seat who we were bringing home was like, no, really, Travis, look. And so he turns his head, he does a double take, he stops the car, he puts it in reverse, and we sit there and we watch these blue lights. And from where my friend in the back and I are sitting, we can see, but Travis can't as he's, you know, in the driver's seat. This white light, it looked like a plane. It looked like a really low plane in the sky type of white light. Came straight at us and then stopped and hovered over the car. And then we just yelled, "Travis, go, go, go!" And we peeled out of there. So,
oh my gosh.
Like, one interpretation of that, which was ours, was like, uh-oh, could we be abducted right now? Like, that's the fear. It's like, this thing is stopping to do something to you. But if it really wanted to, it could have just done something whether we put the car in drive or not. So it didn't. Therefore, could that have gone any other way? Like, was there any other intention behind it except the reveal that whatever this is here? Even though it feels because you're saying, like, the portal opens, they can come and go and all this. And yeah, it feels like that's true, but is that the intention of the experience? Or is it just simply like, look, this is real, and now your wife knows?
I appreciate the question because I feel the same way when I meet other experiencers. I want to ask them these kinds of things, but these kinds of their interpretation, because they were the firsthand witness. They've got the best interpretation of what they, because sometimes there's a little bit of a psychic quality to this, that if you have a hunch about it, your hunch is the most likely to be closest to accurate because you were there, the witnessing, you were present for this. For me, I was dumbstruck. I didn't even have my phone on me, to tell you the truth, to take the picture. Had left it at home. Of course, it happens the time I leave the phone at home. My wife at the time probably had her phone, but didn't think to get it out. And this all happened in, you know, we're talking about, I don't know, 8 seconds, 10 seconds. This is a very quick experience in which reaching for your phone is unfortunately the last thing you're thinking. The first thing is, what's going on? You know, my human mind is trying to comprehend what I'm looking at. And that takes priority over everything. There's no second part of my mind thinking, okay, now get your phone and take a picture. The purpose of this experience is I'm clueless. I'm not psychic. I don't have any sort of those. I'm not an antenna, I guess.
Not yet, anyway.
Some people say they've. I would love to be, but I'm actually very ignorant of this skill. And I'm aware of my ignorance because I don't feel like it's a gift that I have right now.
Right.
And I have heard that people can kind of try to even make a psychic connection with something they see in the sky and ask it to do a thing and it will respond. Though I was not on that level at this point. The UFO stuff was still new to me, and I was starting to accept it, and then all of a sudden it visited me. Mm-hmm. I don't think I was at the point yet to even monitor whether time had passed. You know, I don't know if I had missing time. Do you think you did with your buddies?
No, we didn't have missing time.
Okay, yeah. I don't think I did either, but I also didn't look at the clock. You know, missing time could be 30 minutes. I've heard typically it's an hour.
I don't know. It's funny that people have like a typical, like typically your missing time experience. Generally, it's like we so want to just like know what the unknown is and nail this and make it mechanical, you know? But like, meanwhile, so like your experience, I mean, whether intentional or not on anyone's part, the story of it to me is, this thing exists. Now you know, your wife knows, but you both saw different things, so you don't really know what it is. Like, you just know that you had this amazing experience of something slightly different at the same time. So that should tell you something about the nature of what our ability is to come to know this phenomenon, you know? It really isn't that great.
Yeah. Yeah, you know, but still I just can't. can't help but in my mind try to figure it out, you know, try to piece it together and from hold little gems from stories I hear and see if they correlate with other stories. And, you know, the more scientific way to do that would actually be documenting and doing the statistics on it. And there's some books out there that do that, and I haven't read them yet, but I do intend to.
But if you pull back from that perspective, like if you come out, if it's possible to like come out of yourself for a second and say, okay, but is there a story to that too? Like, the more we document, the more we obsessively try to create data out of this and get nowhere, then yeah. is that because, well, you know, and really, you're trying to, if this is a greater intelligence of some sort, then how are we going to be able to study it? That doesn't make sense. But
no.
Could it be that the act of doing that as a person does something else to you that you come to eventually? You know, and then you look back and you go, oh, this was never really about data collection. This was about this. Do you have any sense of that in your life? Because you've been looking at this for, it sounds like, for a long time.
I'm not sure if I understand. So the data collection could, so if someone was trying to piece these together, that it might actually be something else that they're working on, puzzle they're working on without knowing it?
Well, that the act of doing it, the act of engaging this mystery and trying to figure it out, while it feels like you're doing that because you really want to figure it out, that something about the action of doing that is changing you in a different way that you maybe come to later and go, oh, this was like a growth experience in a completely different way. It was never about proof. Do you ever have that inkling?
Oh, I see. Not that I can think of right now. I always entertain the possibility. I do try to like think about these things. It's kind of fun, but I am more understanding of the reality that we're not meant to know this. We're not meant to understand this. We're not meant to see it. And though some of it tends to reveal itself to us for reasons unknown, I think that there's a lot more out there that we're not seeing.
And that is more than all the time we have for this edition of The Experience. Thank you, everyone, for joining me on my monthly extravaganza journey. Thank you, Robert, for doing this show. I'm going to have him back on fairly soon, I think, because there was some other stuff he wanted to talk about. So I said, let's do another one. And thank you, Tyler, as always, for coming on and book learning us. Much appreciated. For those of you who are interested, go look up Our Undoing Radio in iTunes. The second season is just a couple of weeks in, and it's me trying my best to wake you up. I know, no small task. But if you're into that sort of thing, Our Undoing Radio is the place to be. UnknownCountry.com, also the place to be, as you already know. So please stick around and comment on this episode, and perhaps I will be able to get to those comments in the next episode in a month. All right. Take care, everybody. Thanks for listening.